I'd like to welcome the family and friends of John Frederick Osborne. Our thoughts and prayers go particularly to his sister Velda, his sister-in-law Maureen. We mourn with you. And his nephews and nieces. Well, that is with great sadness that we gather here today. And we recognise the passing of our loved brother and friend and relative, John. And as we pay tribute to his life and commit his mortal remains, I'd like to think that we are uplifted as we share the stories, as the anecdotes of his life, and also recognise the work of God in his life and his hope of eternal life. Now, this afternoon is a time of remembrance. It is mourning. But we are here also to celebrate his life, because it's a life worth celebrating. Really, it was. Oh, sorry. We're going to share his life together through the eyes and the hearts of his family and friends. Toward the end of the service, there'll be an opportunity for anyone to get up and to share your stories. This is not a formal thing. This is about telling John's story. And all of us in this room were part of John's story. We've all got something to share, and when you share, you give part of John's life to someone else who hasn't experienced that life. And between us all, we can bring John's life to its fullness. Yeah? So it's important. We need each other in this. We need each other's stories. After this afternoon's service, we will continue on to Tumut Lawn Cemetery. And then after the service there, it'll only be a short service, you're all invited to come back here and share together in some afternoon tea, some refreshments. If you cannot make it, if you're not up to making it to the lawn cemetery, you're quite welcome to stay here and wait for everyone else to return. But refreshments will not be served until everyone returns. My name is Eddie Oles. And I'm the pastor of Tumut Community Church, where John was a much loved member. He was part of our family. We're a family here. We're only a small church. We're a family. And he was very loved. And he loved us back. And we're all missing. We're all in the same boat. He was a friend. So can we just bow our heads in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, it is with heavy hearts that we gather to mourn the passing of our family member and friend to many, John Osborne. We lift up to you these family members at this time of grief and pray that as we share our stories and declare your work in John's life, that we are uplifted by your Holy Spirit as you fulfil your promise to comfort those who mourn. Amen. I now ask that we join together in some of John's favourite hymns. We have in Jesus to bear. Faithful, faithful, the God.
everything you got in prayer. But if we haven't heard him, oh, what need we make then? Oh, we ask you to not carry everything to God in prayer.
Bye.
and take me home. I dare shall fill my heart. Then I shall die in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. My soul, my Savior God, how great thou art, how great thou art. It sings my soul, my Savior God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
I now invite Maureen Osborne, John's sister-in-law, to please come out and read for us from Matthew 6, verses 9 to 15, and John 3, 16. Do you want me to come up to the microphone? I'll help you. I've got you. Thank you.
I'm reading from Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 to 15, the Lord's Prayer. We can all say this together if you wish. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And from John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Thank you.
Thanks, Maureen. I know we're all going to miss John at this church. Yep, we're all going to miss John. As he was very much a member of our church family. And that's how we see the members of this church. We're a family. We're not a big church, we're a family. With John's, when John's vegetable garden was producing, John would bring in an endless supply of fresh goodies straight from his garden, particularly the tomatoes and the spinach. It was endless. He tried to supply the whole church. Whatever John had, he was happy to share and wanted to share. Just like you do with a family. He embraced us, we embraced him. It was mutual. It was in those family-like relationships in church that John found the freedom to be himself without the need to prove himself as capable or somehow live up to other people's standards or expectations. I know for myself, one of the things I'm going to miss about John is I'm going to miss the way that whenever he had a question or about either one of the announcements or about something that I was saying in a sermon, it would be straight away, Eddie, does that mean that, but Eddie, what about? Now, some people might think that that's a bit rude just to be calling out in the middle of church, but that's how you treat a family, isn't it? When you're with your family and you're having a conversation, you're talking about things, you don't sort of wait till an hour later and get someone by them and say, but wait a minute, what about? That was how John was. This was his family. It was beautiful. John was a man full of surprises. It was pretty easy to assume that because John spoke a bit slowly and he moved a bit slowly, that maybe intellectually he was a bit slow. He wasn't. He had a very sharp mind. And he often amazed me when after service he'd pull me aside and he'd ask me about something from a sermon 4 weeks beforehand, 6 weeks beforehand, anything up to months beforehand. And I've got to admit, sometimes I'd be struggling to remember. He'd say, remember when you preached on, when was that, John? Man, I don't remember preaching that one. When was that? Was that this year? And he'd tell me the date and the scripture verse, and he had it all then. And then we'd sit and we'd talk and he'd share with me what he'd been just really ruminating on for all those weeks until he had it really sort of settled in his heart, and then we'd discuss it. And it was a combination of the lived-out family-like relationships at church and his personal spiritual journey that John, that was in the middle of all that, that John found a relationship with Jesus, a real relationship with Jesus that set him free to embrace and be the person that God created him to be. I want to read something that John wrote in June last year. It's up there. It's headed, as you can see, it's headed My Testimony, and it's dated Sunday the 4th of June, 2023. 2 days, he says, after my 77th birthday. Without Jesus, I thought I was a failure in everything I did, until I repented of my sins and was forgiven by Jesus Christ, who died on the cross at Calvary to save me from my sins and set me free from guilt and depression, hatred, anger, jealousy, lack of confidence, and the mental anguish I was under when I was never completely happy as God wants us to be. When I believed in God again after years of doubt, I no longer believed I was a failure at my university studies, at my work, in marriage attempts, in personal relationships and friendships, in never completing my art studies, in tennis where I failed to play well enough, and with physical and mental problems. But I saw others at my church who faced similar setbacks, but who didn't give up and had a hope in a resurrection and a personal salvation. The Holy Spirit entered my body and gave me gifts of peace, humility, kindness, patience, understanding, hope, and love, and I became a born-again Christian, no longer doubting the word of God found in the Holy Bible and its message of joy, self-respect, confidence, and self-fulfillment for my life from then on and in the future. I believe this revelation of my life has come from Jesus Christ, my Lord and Saviour. I know for myself that there was a noticeable period of time from about the end of 2020 to about the end of 2022 where John really started to be transformed through a deepening relationship with Jesus. It was noticeable. I could see change in him every single week. He was different to the week before. Just the freedom that he was experiencing and the peace and the joy that was overflowing, and his level of faith just grew week by week. See, up until then, John understood that the Bible said that God loved him just as he was. But the burden of guilt and shame from what he saw of himself as a life of failures stood in the way of him understanding that it was because of his failures that God could prove to John that he truly does love him. See, John struggled with the impossible standards of society of what it means to be acceptable. All the usual standards, successful career, a perfect marriage, good at sport and art, lots of friends, ideals that in reality no one ever fully achieves. As we just read in John's own words, with these standards in mind, John truly believed that he was a failure in life. How could God ever love someone so unlovable? That was John's question. I know it was, because it was a question he used to ask me. It was a combination of two things that cemented in John his true value and worth and proved God's unending love for him. Firstly, it was the simple truth of that verse, John 3:16, that Maureen read. And just as importantly, the verses 17 and 18 that follow on from it. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. That whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. John knew all about condemnation. He condemned himself because he couldn't live up to what he thought were his standards, the world's standards. He felt condemned by society because there was no way he could reach the standards, what he thought were the standards of society, or what's portrayed as the standards of society. Man, none of us do. None of us can, when you think about it. And he was sure that God must also condemn him, because how could he ever even come close? If he couldn't live up to the standards of the world, how could he ever come close to living up to the standards of God? It was a simple truth of these verses, a simple truth that John realized was also true for him. For God so loved the world. The world. And that must mean, you know, not just pastors or priests or people involved in serving in churches, but the world, everyone and everyone, every single person on this planet. And that meant for John, God loved John Osborne just as he was. Just as he was. He didn't have to prove anything to God. I actually remember when the penny dropped for him. It was like, it was just this switch turned on and it was bang. It was changed. It was a beautiful time. Amazing moment. See, John realised that he wasn't about what he'd done or hadn't done. But actually, it was all about what God had provided through Jesus. That he can be forgiven because of what Jesus had already done. It was as simple as that. He didn't have to prove himself. He didn't have to make things right. And it meant for him that he realised he could not only be forgiven, but he experienced the fullness of God's love, and in that respect was able to really show love and understand love and live a life of love. And there was this transformation happened in him. And he came to know the fullness of love that God not only promised John, but promises each and every human being on this planet. And it is a love that's eternal. It goes on forever with a life promised with God over our physical time on earth has ended. That's what John 3:16 is all about. His favourite verse. And the second thing that cemented these scriptures in John's heart so that he knew that the Bible is true is that John experienced for himself that very same love lived out through the relationships he encountered here in his church family. A group of people who also knew what it is to not be good enough in the eyes of society, but to know for themselves the full acceptance and life-changing love of God through Jesus Christ. And it's because of that single promise of God's love that he loves us, that he loves John, and that John believed what God said about him, that we can know for sure that although we are saddened by John's death, we can celebrate the fact that John has now entered the fullness of eternal life with God. And that's something to celebrate. It really is. And I know from the many cups of tea I've had with John and the countless hours of discussions that we've had, that there's a question that John would want me to ask you this afternoon. Do you know the love of God for yourself? John knew for himself the fullness of God's acceptance and love and the promise of eternal life that God guarantees for all who choose to believe. For all that choose to believe. A promise that doesn't depend on what you or I or John haven't done or have done or will do or won't do, but depends totally on what Jesus has already done when he died on the cross at Calvary. Do you know that peace and that hope and that joy that John wrote about? Do you want to? Just talk to me later and embark on that same journey as John, because it transformed his life. So it's with sadness and loss that we have tears of mourning at John's death, but it's with joy and peace of the knowledge that for John, this is just the start of something new. This is the start of an eternal life that we celebrate together with the angels in heaven. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for John's life. Thank you for the way that your love uplifted him and strengthened him throughout his times of struggle. Thank you, Jesus, that John still lives, that he shares in that eternal life that you have promised, and he suffers no more. Amen. Can we all stand together, if you can? Let's stand together and sing another one of John's favourites, and it's an updated version of an old hymn, Amazing Grace.
Thanks.
Can I move it over, because that's got effects on it, and they've got the microphone on board for the recording. I'll move it over for you. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Mercy reigns.
To the front here?
Yeah, I'm sorry to copy it.
Just going to move this microphone to make it a bit easier.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name's Chris Osborne. I'm one of the nephews of John. There's about 11 of us, so I think, nephews and nieces.
Me too.
In more recent years, John became sort of concerned about some issues outside, and he became concerned about climate change, and he also became concerned about our Indigenous people. And he joined the Greens before the last federal election, and he handed out for them and letterboxed. So he's a member of the Greens Party, which was a big change for John. So I'd like to acknowledge the country that we're celebrating John's life on here today, the traditional custodians of this land, the Wurundjeri people. Their elders past, present and emerging. I've got apologies from my sister Karen Abernathy, from her son Rod Abernathy, from Gillian Osborne, from Greg Thornton cousin, from Royce Thornton cousin, and from Todd, Paul and Jodie Osborne cousins. What a great and humbling privilege it is for me to be up here standing before you today to celebrate the life of this incredibly warm and uniquely talented man. You'll see at the bottom of your service sheet that John himself designed, and in fact, John planned his whole funeral himself. I've had to do very little in the last few days except liaise with Pastor Eddie and with Braden from the funeral home, because John organised everything, including selecting the flowers, the coffin, everything. So at the bottom of the service sheet, it says, a friend to all people. And that's what he was. That's what I've discovered, and that's what I've found out since I've been down in Tumut in the last few weeks, visiting him, respite, and all that sort of stuff. On Friday, I found a pile of handwritten notes that John had left me with all manner of writings, like poems of all sorts, with enough to actually put in and publish a book of poetry, and notes and instructions to me on what he wanted me to say in this eulogy, and also this that I found was called My Life by John Frederick Osborne, and he wrote everything about his life in here, and I was able to use this as a reference because I wanted to honour his instructions to me about what he wanted me to say. And in that, he talks about his childhood, which which my Aunt Valda and John's sister will talk about. His struggles with his mental illness, his experience with this church, and his newfound faith, that he became a born-again Christian and accepted God in his heart, and was baptised by Pastor Trevor in the Tumut River in a full immersion ceremony some years ago. I had to start my eulogy from scratch after I discovered all these papers. And one statement that I came across in these handwritten notes was this statement, which shows why he chose the theme on the bottom of your sheets I just mentioned. He says this: "I do not want to be remembered for my accomplishments. I only want to be remembered for the friendships I have made in my life and the love that I have shown others." As I said, after I speak, my Auntie Valda will talk about John's earlier life growing up in Epping. And so, but there are a couple of things that I want to touch on, because Valda and I had a wonderful two-hour discussion on Saturday. I wanted to make sure that I wasn't going to steal her thunder or anything, and also too that she knew John in those childhood days better than anybody, because she was close to John in age and used to look after him a lot. I'm going to concentrate on his life in Tumut, which was the happiest he had in his life since his childhood with his family, until his first breakdown in his 20s. How do you sum up a man's life and their contributions in just a short address like we are today? It's very hard, but John was a unique man, as Eddie has also said, very clever, of high intelligence and talent, and he had unbelievable courage to put aside his affliction and get on with the best life he could and have a go at most things. He had an engaging personality and made friends through the many activities he joined down here. In the last 2 weeks, I have spoken to many Tumut residents. It seems that everybody knew him and they all spoke very highly of him and his gentle and very kind nature. After Valda speaks, John's nephew and Valda's son, Robert, will talk about his recollections of John when they lived at Tumut. Robert spent a lot of time with John in those years. Valda will tell you the reason, but he was really named Frederick John Osborne, and that's what his birth was registered as, and not John Frederick Osborne. Valda will explain why he became John. A couple of anecdotes about John from his school days I know of. He attended Epping Boys High 3 years after it opened. It was a selective school, and one of his best classmates and friends was Geoffrey Robinson, the international famed human rights lawyer and compere of the ABC program many years ago called Hypotheticals. John was a member, along with Geoffrey Robinson, of the school chess club and played tennis with Geoffrey on weekends, and when they're at university together, they also played tennis there. One thing I didn't know about John that I came across was that he joined the CMF, which became the Army Reserve, for 7 months in 1975-76 at the Water Transport Division in Mosman, where he learnt to drive a mechanised landing craft, and he was out at Holsworthy where he learnt to use and shoot an SLR rifle. I just never heard of that before, so that blew me away. He also studied many languages like French and did very well in the Levy certificate in French, Italian, Spanish, and he was very engaging with my then Colombian wife Maria when we visited in Spanish conversation when we came down. He had an acting career, and one of the photographs on the front there today, and you'll see more photographs of John that were taken by a professional photographer for his portfolio when he got an agent to start acting. He loved acting in plays. Until the age of 13, from 3 to 13, he had elocution lessons, and he appeared at a Stedford's from the age of 6, speaking poetry, and he won a number of trophies, and locals would know that his love of poetry continued down here, reading his own poetry over the local FM radio station Sounds of the Mountains. He was a page boy as well when he was young, to very well-known people that were connected with my grandfather, Sir Claude Plowman and Major General George Bennett, who was a World War II hero and also a Major General in the CMF after the war. At age 12, he tried out for a part in the Chips Rafferty film Smiley, but missed out. He tried out for the 2GB children's radio program at the time, Children Are Funny. Few people knew that before his mental health issues came forth, he loved acting and appeared in lead roles in school plays like Noah, where he played Noah, and Ned Kelly when he played the lead role. He was a member of the musical Manly Music Society and sang and acted in the musicals Mame and the Vagabond King and the Willoughby Musical Society, where he played Tristan the Hermit and Noel Coward's Blithe Spirit. As I said, he had professional photographs done and an agent. He played as an extra in the film The Man from Hong Kong and Newsfront that the James Bond actor George Lazenby played in. And he also played an extra in The Odd Angry Shot that Graham Kennedy shot, which was about Vietnam. He also played a few times as an extra in the TV soap opera Number 96, for those who remember. When he moved to Richmond, he joined the Richmond Players and appeared in Here Comes the Bride, Give My Regards to Broadway and others. In Tumut, he played If These Walls Could Talk, A History of the Montreal Theatre, and two short films produced by Valmar, Tracks Winding Back and Goldfields. And I know Terry was in those as well, those short films. It was during the second year at university that John suffered his first major episode under the strain of study and the enormous pressure he placed upon himself in order to fulfil his mother's expectations, that was to see an almost lifelong struggle with mental illness, except in the more recent years when he came to Tumut. For those who in here who have had or have family members with mental health issues, you would know that this can be a huge struggle for those suffering with a lot of anguish, lost opportunities, lost dreams for possible careers and relationships that never happened. And John lamented himself to me many times of those lost opportunities, and he also would have done that to Eddie, which Eddie just spoke about. To say that this second part of John's life was torturous on a personal level was an understatement. Further lost opportunities at the University of New South Wales attempting an arts degree would set him back and provoke outbreaks of his mental health once again. He tried a third time at the University of New England, but that also became too much. So he kept trying regardless of his affliction. He just kept trying all the time. He never gave up. In between episodes, he would find solace in acting, as mentioned previously, with the Richmond Players. And I once picked him up from the train from down here many years ago, took him to Richmond for the bicentenary of the first play that was put on in the colony of New South Wales. Other ways that he used to, when he was in mental anguish, was to do these cross-stitched tapestries while in Richmond, some of which you can see here today, that he entered into the Tumut show and won first prize. Getting back to his Tumut story. After John's mother, Dulcie, passed away in 2000, John drifted a little, and in 2004, my father, Bruce, and his wife, Maureen, decided to bring him down to their home in Tumut for a bit of a rest, and from that time, John's life dramatically changed for the better. After John decided to stay in Tumut and get back on his feet, John moved into a two-bedroom apartment in Clark Street, and there he met his lifelong friend, Terry McGrath, his closest and best friend for 20 years. Even when John finally decided that it was time for him to go into Uniting Care a week before he passed, there he was just two doors down from Terry, and every chance Terry got, he went in to visit John in his room. Prior to John's failing health at the end of December, John was visiting Terry every Saturday in Uniting Care, reading to him. And he'd ring me up and ask me to purchase a number of golden books. When we were kids, we had golden books, and he'd give me the list of the books that he wanted to read to Terry, and I'd have to search on the internet, find them, purchase them, and get them delivered to John. and John would go up and read those to Terry on a Saturday. I was always astonished at this friendship, and when I visited them in Terry, in Tumut, Terry would sit by and listen intensely to the conversations John and I had together and would contribute where he could. When my father assisted John to buy his own house in Tumut in 2006, John absolutely insisted that Terry come with him. If you have ever seen the movie or the TV series The Odd Couple, a similar scenario established in John's house where Terry played, Terry was the Felix character with his almost photographic memory for his and John's various appointments and his fastidious attention for detail, while Uncle was the Oscar character who was more laid back and relaxing and took it all as it came. John set about his busy schedule of activities during the week by enrolling in the local TAFE to do a 3-year art certificate, which he completed, and then immediately enrolled again for the same course and did another 3 years. He's had many exhibitions that were subject to news art, news items and photographs in the local paper, and he entered his artworks and his needlework, as I said before, in the Tumut show. There's just three of his artworks here at the back, but he did many more. At the same time as this, he had a part-time job with Pine Corps, where he worked for 11 years, and he absolutely insisted that he was going to retire at 70. I had suggested to him he could retire at 65, and he said, no, I'm going till 70. Both John and Terry enjoyed their annual Valmar holiday trips together, and once John went to Vietnam on tour. He and Terry also went to Tasmania together. The list of John's activities began to grow as he wanted to experience as much as he could and fill his week up with interesting activities. Over the years, he was a member of Sing Australia, where he loved going with the group to entertain elderly people at local aged care homes and performing on special occasions like Australia Day. He went to Writing for the Disabled, where he was selected, because he was a little trepidatious about the horse, they selected the most placid and older horse for him, which he rode until the horse died, and John decided after that he wouldn't ride horses anymore, but he used to still go and watch and engage in conversation with those around him. He used to go weekly to a craft group. He'd go weekly to a cooking group where he looked forward to finishing the session, because John was always in for a good feed, especially when he didn't have to pay for it. John was always into a good meal. As I said, he went to the Tumut Men's Shed in the last couple of years, and his lounge room mantelpiece attests to the number of wooden objects he turned out. He started going to the Scrabble group on a Friday morning, a game he always loved, along with chess, and I remember as a child he taught me chess and we used to play Scrabble. He went to country music once a month every Sunday because he loved singing so much and was never shy to jump up and have a go. I went, when I stayed down here for the 6 months from January, 5 months from January to May 2014, assisting Maureen with my father before he passed, I would take John and Terry to many activities, and I took them up to country music, and he challenged me to get up and do a duet with him, so we did that. He went to walking group, which he did until his arthritis set in and his legs gave him a bit of grief. He was a regular at the Montreal cinema here in town. He loved movies and the cinema experience, and also the live shows and the artists that were put on there. He recently joined an exercise group with some elderly ladies, and he was the only male in the group, and he loved that. He was a huge fan of the local community FM radio station, Sounds of the Mountains, and he had that on all the time in the house when he wasn't out. He recorded his own poems and his own songs, which we heard as we came in this morning. The announcer, Dave, has kindly given me those recordings and I've started distributing those recordings to family. What astonished me since John passing, and while assisting Braden, the funeral director, and Pastor Eddie, is the huge network that John and Terry established here in Tumut, and the outpouring of sorrow and commiserations relayed to me from people around here from all walks of life, who knew and loved John, and the kind descriptions of him being a very friendly, a very gentle man, and everybody in town knew that John and Terry were best mates. John would rarely pass someone in the street that he didn't know and say hello. Anybody you talked to in Tumut knew John. If they didn't know his name, they knew him by sight. A businessman, Ian, next door to John's house, told me the other day that the very first day he opened his business next to John's house, John wandered in, introduced himself, and welcomed him to the community. That's what he was like. Just up the road from John was opened a coffee shop and health food store run by a woman called Leanne, called Simply Wholesome. John became a regular at that every morning. He would go down there and order a turmeric latte that he told me was going to fix up his arthritis in his legs. When I saw her a couple of days ago to tell her that John had passed, she already knew because this is a small town, and she gave me her condolences and told me as well what a gentle, kind and wonderful man he was. His history here in Tumut was one of courage because he fought to overcome his mental health issues, and during that 20 years, the number of episodes that he had were very few than those of his previous life before coming here. And that's a testament to how happy he was. But it didn't mean he wasn't anxious sometimes, because he was, and he became a little bit obsessed by certain things, including the clock. And if you spoke to him and said, "I'll ring you tomorrow, Uncle," and he said, "What time?" And I'd say, 4 o'clock, and I was ringing him daily since December for the 2 months he was in hospital or respite, and I had to come to a stage where I negotiated with him for me to have a 15-minute leeway, because if I didn't ring on the dot, he would be ringing me up. So Maureen and I would get phone calls sometimes when he had a question or he had a problem, and Maureen would try to sort them out, and she would ring me up and tell me that she saw John down the road, and she would express concern to me at the time that she thought that things might have been good or that I should check something out on John's behalf. And Maureen and I, in the 10 years that I looked after John after my father asked me to do that, Maureen and Dad looked after him the prior 10 years to that. Over the last 2 years, he decided it was time to reduce his medication to see what lay beyond that, and he got his GP to engage a specialist in Sydney and would talk to him every 6 months by video link, and the medication process reduction started. He refused for his carer to come in with him on the session, and that was unusual for John because the carer always went to the doctor and specialist sessions and would take a few notes and send me an email about what transpired so I could keep up to date with John's health. He also refused me to sit in on it when the specialist would ask me to sit in on that. But the specialist would ring me up after those sessions and tell me what was going on. Myself, Maureen and Velma were very concerned about this medication reduction, but we noticed positive changes in him about 12 months ago, where his energy picked up greatly, his outlook improved, and his mood changed for the better. I was hoping, and Velma were hoping, and because I spoke to them many times, and Maureen was, that he wasn't going to go too far. But on a conversation I had with him when I drove him up to the Liverpool Hospital in early December to have a procedure done, when I started talking to him about this, he said, "No, I'm going all the way." He said, "I feel so happy, I'm going all the way to reduce that medication." And I said, he said he felt terrific, that he was happier than he'd ever been in his life except from childhood, and was undertaking tasks that he'd been unmotivated about in the past and had been putting off for a long time, like cleaning out the cupboards in the house and he began donating excess items to places in town, books and things like that. John's personality had some quirks, and so did his logic, which were part and parcel of who John was, and these traits also endeared him to people here. Many times he made me laugh out loud, and we'd laugh together when he made a statement that was slightly off kilter, and many times he made me frustrated when he would say the same statement to me over and over again and have to describe to me in fine detail the meal that he'd had the night before when he went out with his Valmar friends. Just over 18 months ago, I had a conversation with him in his house with Terry, listening about the positive thing of benefits of doing a prepaid funeral, because Maureen and Dad had done it, and I said to John, this would save your relatives a lot of organising and a lot of anguish. And so after a couple of months, he rang me up and he said, I want to do it. And so I organised to come down in the January, an appointment with Braden and John, and took him there. He took a bunch of notes with him that he wanted to do, and Braden very calmly and very professionally went through the quotation template, and we got up to two parts, and one was Braden said to us, are you guys comfortable with having a look at the coffins? And we both said yes. So we went through the funeral home and he opened a door and there was three coffins on one side and three on the other, and this was down the bottom. And John just looked at it and he said, that one, that's what I'm having, before Braden could open his mouth. So he loved the Tumut area and the Tumut River, and he took like half a second to choose that. Another item that came up on Braden's list was, Braden got down to embalming. And then Braden said, not many people have embalming these days because it's very expensive. A word Uncle used to shy away for a lot when he needed maintenance and things done in the house. He wanted to know straight away how much it was going to cost. Braden said that he'd have to get a contract embalmer from Canberra or Sydney. There was momentary silence, and I could see Uncle's mind ticking over, and Braden and I were waiting for his comment to come out, and he said, no, I want it. And I said to him, Uncle, if you don't mind, can I please ask you why? He blurted out immediately, because of the worms. And I couldn't help but just crack up, looked over at Braden, who was being the quintessential professional he is. He was trying to contain himself in a scenario that was structured to be very solemn and serious. Braden then said to him that he had a duty to disclose to John that such a process only lasts 10 to 15 years. Once again, you could see John's mind ticking over. He was calculating what Braden had said. Then he suddenly says, oh, that's okay. By that time, it won't matter. With a wry look in his eye and a very slight grin in the corner of his mouth. And once again, I cracked up. These two statements were quintessentially John. It was just like him. He was a great fan of British comedians like Spike Milligan and Tony Hancock, who used sarcasm and wit. And he could also crack a wry joke when the situation called for it. This last week, hearing about all this vast network of acquaintances and people talking to me about how they knew him and admired me with a smile on their face, breaking through their sorrow for his passing, made me very, very proud. I have to mention my stepmother Maureen, which I have just before, who over this last couple of months was of great assistance to John and myself, as I was in Queensland at a retreat, and I cut that short because it needed me to come down to talk to John and assist him make some very difficult and profound decisions that he had to make. Maureen and I worked very closely together in unison and discussed every step, and it worked very well. She has always been a friend to John, not only because John was her husband's brother, but because John had this amazing ability to endear himself to those who he crossed paths with. I know John loved Maureen dearly and trusted her implicitly and sought her advice, and they had a special spiritual bond through their respective faiths that I didn't have with John. Uncle, you've gone far too soon, and I was looking forward to many more years of visiting you and assisting you when you needed it. This part of your life here in Tumut was your happiest, along with your childhood in Epping, with your family. You overcame great obstacles, and despite your issues, you tried very hard to place them to one side and get on with your life. Your dedication to your friendship with Terry is most admirable, and I know with great confidence Terry will never forget you, and nor will many residents of this great and beautiful town. And I know for sure that your family won't. I will miss you very much. Your phone calls, my visits over the last 10 years, especially being able to stay with you in your house, more recently after Terry went into care, that I know you look forward to. I do have one regret, and that I wasn't able to fulfil one request you gave me a year or so ago when you asked me to take you to Casillas in the Hunter Valley to see the farm named Langolan, where our convict ancestor William Osborne was assigned and lived for 10 years. I'm sorry, very sorry that I wasn't able to fulfil that request. I'm going to try and do that trip myself, and I'll have you in my heart. Thank you for being you. Thank you for allowing me to share a small part of your life. John loved poetry since he was a little boy, so I find it fitting to read this short poem. And when I rise, let me rise like a bird joyfully. And when I fall, let me fall like a leaf gracefully without regret. And when I stand, let me stand like a tree strong and tall. And when I lie, let me lie like a lake peacefully calm and still. And when I work, let me work like a bee wholeheartedly. And when I play, let me play like a breeze refreshingly light and clear. Uncle, may you rest in peace.
Thanks, Chris, for sharing that part of your uncle's life with us. Yeah. I'll now invite Velda and also Robert McDermott, John's nephew, his sister and nephew, to please come up and share with us some of your aspects of John's life. Thank you.
I'll bring it down a little bit. Bring it down. This comes here. Hello, everyone. My name is Velda McDermott, John's one and only sister, and now sadly the sole surviving sibling in our family. As we rewind to the 2nd of June 1946, when John made his grand debut at Ryde Hospital. I was a sprightly bit over 7-year-old. Bruce was in the throes of teenage angst at 15, and Ken was just trying to navigate being 12. I remember when he was born. Yes, those were the good old days when mum's got a 2-week vacation after giving birth. My mother's room had a window. I wasn't allowed to go in, but I could wave to her through the glass. I remember my father came and got me and took me to the nursery. We couldn't go in, but the nurse held John up through the glass window so my father and I could see him. My mother was a good mother and looked after John when he came home. In fact, she did that her entire life until she passed away in the year 2000. John was a cute little blonde boy who spent most of his adolescence life with me. Fortunately for him, I remained blissfully stuck in my preteen bubble until the ripe age of 18, ensuring our bond remained strong. Growing up in Epping was so much fun for John and me. Mum put us both in elocution. John was only 4 and I was 12, and venture I quickly abandoned, but John excelled, wowing audience and winning numerous Steadfords. His confidence soared so much that it led him into the world of acting. I was John's mentor in all things fun and games. We loved playing shuttlecock up the side of the house most evenings. I introduced him to tennis, where he became rather a handy player and used to also play a lot with his friends and me. Mum and Dad and John and I loved going to the movies at the Epping Theatre. It was a real treat for us. The theatre always had 2 movies, so at half time we'd go next door for an ice cream and a chocolate. I remember when we were at the movies and an announcement came over that King George VI had died, and we all had to stand up and sing God Save the Queen. Our holidays at Wagstaff Point at the Central Coast were idyllic. Just the 4 of us, Mum, Dad, John and I, soaking up the sun and surf. We'd get the train sometimes and then the ferry, but these days they've built a bridge. There was a group of my father's friends, so John and I would have a great time playing with the other children. We enjoyed playing on the beach, building sandcastles, and having fun in the water and on the canoes at Edelong. Later on, my father bought some land at Yamina, also the Central Coast, and Ken built a great cabin for the 4 of us to play, to stay in, complete with a kitchenette, plenty of storage, and sleeping quarters. We used to have so much fun. We would take our dog and go exploring and walk down through the bushes to the beach where we'd swim and play for hours, called there. John and I went to Epping Primary School, and following that I went to Hornsby Home Science High, and John went to Epping High, where he was a top scholar and was a boys only school. I went to college whilst John was still in school, and then at the age of 21, I went to Tasmania on a working holiday, leaving behind a huge void in John's life. My mother said John missed me terribly. I was away for about 8 months, and when I came back, he was so happy. But that was short-lived, as I went back to Tasmania to get married. So once again, John was lonely and missed me so much. When I got married, Dad brought John over because my mother was already there. She came earlier with my niece, Vicky. Vicky was my flower girl, and Mum's skilled hands made every garment, including my wedding dress. With John being such a fantastic, bright and clever student, the aspirations for John's future were pushed forward into medicine by my mother, envisaging a path she believed would secure his success. But I'm sure he didn't love it. John was a top student in history, and my father saw potential for John in law. But my mother got her way, and in John's second year, the weight of expectations proved too burdensome, leading to a profound mental struggle and a subsequent nervous breakdown that forever would alter his life. My father secured him a job on the roads, providing structure and purpose during the day, whilst evenings were dedicated to his passion for acting and environment in theatre groups, and weekends were a welcome break filled with the camaraderie of tennis matches amongst friends. However, John's dream was to graduate from uni. He wanted to don the ceremonial gown and hat and have everyone watch him on the podium receive his degree. But sadly, that was never to happen. He did go back to uni for another 2 years. It was meant to be 3 years, but in the beginning of the third year, the professor told my parents that he was desperately struggling and the fear of another breakdown loomed large. In 1974, circumstances aligned and I returned to Sydney with my own family, husband Jeff and 3 children, Jeffrey, Leanne and Robert, along with 2 poodles and a cat. We all lived with Mum, Dad and John for the few years in Fairlight for about, you know, so many months before we found our own place just around the corner. The bond shared among Mum, Dad, John and my own family were incredibly tight-knit, and it was rare for a day to pass without us seeing each other. After school, the kids would make their way to their grandparents' house where they'd join John for a round of tennis across the road before returning for cups of tea and slices of cake. John loved it in the summer. Most weekends we'd go to Queenscliff Beach and hang out on the beach, pool, and have loads of fun. We also holidayed together and were pretty much inseparable. When we moved to Harbord, into a corner store with a residence behind, Mum, Dad and John wanted to move closer to us. They missed out on a house at Curl Curl, ended up with a nice big white house in Regent Street, DY. John used to come over occasionally and help us in the shop and loved serving the customers. When my father passed away in 1984, my mother thought at the ripe old age of 38, she would purchase a unit down the road from her to finally granting John a taste of independence. By this time, my son Robert was living in Richmond, so we'd often take Mum and John up for picnics on the weekend. We'd all bring our chairs, blankets, food and drinks and spread out in the park near the river in Windsor. We did it so often that Mum thought I wouldn't mind living up there myself. So my brother Bruce helped her source some land she could build on, with one house being for her and eventually one across the road for John in a pretty little gated community called Tebbutt Mews. My mother joined every kind of club possible, and so did John. John was in a church group and a performing arts group called the Richmond Players. They would put on musicals and dramas where he loved to sing and act. Evenings for my mother and John were often spent at the Richmond RSL, enjoying dinners and those lively rounds of bingo, surrounding by his hobbies and the company of Mum and my son Robert. John found fulfillment in the bustling little community of Richmond. When my mother passed away in the year 2000, I think John was truly lost without her. Their inseparable bond left a void that seemed impossible to fill. My brother Bruce took John under his wing, bringing him to Tumut, where John immersed himself in various groups and found solace in his writing and art. A heartfelt expression of gratitude goes out to Maureen for being John's steadfast support, especially when my brother Bruce passed. I don't think there was really a day gone by that she didn't visit or contact him, and I know he thought the world of her. But for me, Tumut was a long way away from Sydney, so from then on, I didn't get to see him very much. Though distance kept us apart, we would write letters and send cards to one another and gifts, and we'd talk on the phone. I'm so lucky that I got to see John only a month ago, where he seemed quite bright and was excited to be going home. It's hard to grasp that he's no longer with us. My little brother, whom I will always remember so fondly, all the fun we had growing up will be treasured with me forever. The passage of time has certainly been wrought with significant changes. Our childhood home in Epping now stands as a cluster of units. Our schools were echoes of the past, and my parents' house in DY pulled down. My two older brothers, Bruce and Ken, sadly gone, and now John, the baby of the family. Life is truly so short and serves as a poignant reminder the importance we fill each day with fun and love and plenty of laughter. Despite grappling with mental health challenges throughout his adult life, John was fortunate to have the unwavering support of my parents, who ensured his financial stability. He was blessed to always have a place to call home, and eventually the liberating embrace of independence in securing his own home, courtesy of my mother. John approached each day with courage, embracing life's adventures and savouring its treasures. As we grieve his absence, we may take solace in the fact that I know he's sitting up in heaven with my mother, and they are both smiling down upon all of us here as we honour and celebrate John's life. Thank you. Okay.
Hi, folks. I promise I'll be not as long as those ones, but I've just got a few little messages. One's from, sorry, I need my glasses. This is from Jodie Osborne. She's John's niece and the daughter of John's second oldest brother, Ken. So she wanted to say a few words, and they're sorry they couldn't be here today. So she wrote, when reflecting on my Uncle John's life, my mind drifts back to our childhood days spent visiting Grandma and Grandpa's home in DY. Those memories are etched in my mind forever, filled with laughter, mischief and warmth of family bonds. Grandma always prepared feasts that seemed to stretch for miles. Among the bounty of food, John would quietly retreat to his room. Seeking solace amidst the chaos of us kids running around. Kathy would probably know about that one because she's around the same age as me and my cousins. They took it upon themselves to tease and bother him, finding joy in disrupting his perfectly arranged personal items and his space. But what stands out the most was John's patience. Despite their antics, he never lost his cool or chased them away from his sanctuary. Beyond the walls of DY, John would join Grandma and Grandpa in their visits to their Sylvania Waters home. He became a familiar presence during many visits and always added warmth to their Christmas Day celebrations. So today, on behalf of John's brother, Ken's family, I would very much like to extend our heartfelt gratitude to Bruce and Maureen for their support and dedication to John throughout the years he spent in Tumut, and particularly to Maureen, following the passing of Bruce, for her unwavering devotion. Thanks, Maureen. And from my point of view, sorry, I'll be quick, but we need to lighten this up a bit, don't you think? So when we moved to Tasmania, when Mum moved up from Tasmania, I was about 6 years old, and John was always part of our life from me growing up, from being this young fellow there, and my brother and sister. And there was Kathy up the road. She'd always join us as well. And we'd always go to the beach with John. We loved our surf mats. John loved going down to the beach. That was fantastic. And then we, and then there was a lot of sport we played. Mum got John into tennis and squash. And as I became a teenager, he took me to play squash at DY. There was squash courts. There was a gymnasium run by the Manly Warringah, a couple of famous rugby league players. And John decided, I'm going to get fit and you're coming with me. So we knew nothing about going to the gym, what weights were, anything. We walked in, we lifted a few weights, we looked around, thought this is great. They had a spa. We thought, let's go to the spa. That looks pretty good. Let's go to the spa. I had a swimming costume, but unfortunately John didn't. And he decided at a unisex spa that he would go in the nude. So I said to John, I think I was about 13 or 14 years old, John, it's unisex. You can't be showing off little John like that. So he didn't care, but luckily for me, no embarrassment for me because no females came in at that point in time. So then we moved, as the years went on, I moved to Richmond, as my mother said. Grandma moved up there, John moved up there, so we spent a lot of time together. I was in the firework industry. I spent a lot of time travelling the world. Grandma decided myself should take John to Singapore. That'd be great. That'd be a great experience for John. He can go with me. So she booked him a ticket. She found out I told her where we were staying. I took him to Singapore. He loved it, absolutely loved it. I was working all the time. John would be waiting in the foyer every day, and I said, John, you've got to get out there. You've got to go and enjoy Singapore. I can't go with you. I'm working. So I booked him into lots of tours, which he went. He was there, but every day, every afternoon, he was there waiting for myself and my team. So one night, we're working with the Singapore military. They said, come on, guys, we're going to take you out for the night. And I said, I have my uncle John with me. He'd like to come along. And they said, yeah, that's fine, bring him along. So we went to the officer's mess. I'm not sure whether John had alcohol prior to that. I asked my mother that. She said, no, she didn't believe so. But he enjoyed himself. He had a couple of beers, had a great night. But I do know the next day he missed that bus tour. So I'm not sure what happened the next day, but he missed that bus tour. But he came back. Grandma was happy. He had a great time. And he remembers it because I saw him not that long ago and we actually did talk about it. So as the years went on, John came to my marriage. He came to christenings. He saw my little girls grow up. They went down to the Tebbutt Mews. They enjoyed swimming and I had them jump into his arms and he absolutely loved it. I think he just absolutely loved the embrace. He was taken back a little bit in the beginning, but when he's just enjoyed the embrace of these two little nieces, just enjoying his company. So as the years went on, Grandma obviously got sick around 2000. She got ill, she came down here and passed away. And I had the not so nicest task in the world to go and see John. He was in St. John of God having a little bit of treatment and I was asked to go up and let him know that his mother had passed away. So it wasn't the nicest experience for myself, but John took it in his stride. He took a deep breath like I just did then and he thought about it. He came back home. Grandma was buried. He tried to stay at Richmond for as long as he could. I'd spoken to Maureen and Uncle Bruce. What are we going to do? Because he used to come round to my place all the time. He was lost. He was really lost. So they decided the best thing for John was to bring him down here, which we're glad he did because look at all these fantastic friends he made. It just turned him around. He absolutely loved it. I'd come down and visit with my mother. These paintings behind, he was so proud of his paintings. There was an artist in the family, Uncle Harold, which he adored, and I think he thought he was a little bit like Uncle Harold, and a couple of those pictures you can see a little bit of Uncle Harold there. And my last visit down here was only about 5 weeks ago with my mother when we went to Batlow to see him. And I got to spend about half an hour having a chat to him and he brought up these paintings. He was wanting to know who he is going to leave them to. Who wanted his paintings? Who does he think? But at the end of the day, I'd said to him, listen, I'm coming back, don't worry, I'm coming back. He wanted to know whether my family would come down, my wife and my little baby son, Thomas, who's only 5. He hadn't met him before. So I said, listen, I'm coming back. And he said, oh, I want to live to 80, you know. 80 is my goal, the same age as my grandfather. So unfortunately that didn't happen, but I said to John, listen, you're my last uncle. You're not going anywhere. You're absolutely not going anywhere. And I said, I will be back. Unfortunately, I'm back and we're here. And we didn't get to fulfill his dream to talk about who he wanted to leave these special paintings to. So I'm sure he's up there looking down going, well, you'll work it out. You'll work it out. I'm sure you will. So rest in peace, John. And thank you for everyone for attending. It's fantastic to see you had so many fantastic friends and the family for all coming down and being part of this celebration for John's life. Thank you.
Now I'd like to have a time of an open microphone for anyone to come and share their stories, their anecdotes, their memories. I know that Terry, you'd like to come forward, please, to you got something you want to say? Can we have... Sorry? Oh, okay, change of mind. No worries, mate. Yeah, absolutely. Please, anyone can come up and... This is the time to help fill in that kaleidoscope of John's life.
Hi, my name's Denise. I work for Valmar Support Services. I was very fortunate to have worked for John for some periods of time, on and off over the years, as has many more of my colleagues, and a lot of our clients and participants are here. John and I shared a love of music, we shared a love of poetry, we shared a love of acting, and he enjoyed seeing me on stage at times, as I did with him. I had a poem that's one of my favourites, and it's by Robert Burns, and John was blown away that a woman, knows about Robert Burns and knows his poem. So this is from me to John, and it's epitaph to a friend. And I've lost it here. Where is it? Heidi. Sorry, I had it on her phone. Okay. It's an epitaph to a friend from Robert Burns. An honest man, he lies at rest, as heir with God, his image blessed. A friend of man, a friend of truth, a friend of age, and a friend of youth. Few hearts like this with virtue warmed, few heads with knowledge so informed. If there's another world, he lives in bliss. If there's none, he made the best of this. Fail, John.
Is there anyone else that would like to share anything, any stories or anecdotes from John's life? Right now, Harold would like to do a song in tribute of John. John was a big fan of country music and was a regular at the meetings down at the Golf Club here for the Country Music Club.
Yes.
So,
yes, the
please, Harold.
The mic's working great.
Well, my name is Harold. It's not Uncle Harold. Not the Harold. But John introduced me to the Country Music Club just up the road here at the Golf Club. And every third Sunday, they have a Country Music Club. And every third Sunday, John said, are you coming to the music this afternoon? I said, yes, John. So So I took him a couple of times as well. And he didn't have anyone to back him sometimes. And I said, look, he loved this song, The Rivers of Babylon. I said, look, I'll learn the song and then I can back you. So the following week, I said, John, on the following 3 weeks, month later, I said, John, would you like to do The Rivers of Babylon? And he said, no, he said, I'm going to do a poem. So now I understand, after all this, a strong will, a strong mind. But just what I like to do on behalf of the Country Music Club and quite a few people here, and in honour of him, I like to play that song. Just for him. So I'll do that now. As long as I keep it together.
By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yeah, we wept. We remembered Zion. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yeah, we wept. We remembered Zion. When the wind had carried us away in captivity, requiring from us a song. Now how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? When the wind had carried us away in captivity, requiring from us a song. Now how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Ooh. 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 Yeah, 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 yeah. That's the words of our mind, the meditation of our heart. The example in the sight, here tonight. Let the words of our mouth, the meditation of our heart. The example in the sight, here tonight.
Thank you, Harold. We're now going to have a visual display, a pictorial display of John's life and memories of him.
Tomorrow is too far away. Tomorrow is long to delay. Tomorrow, today will be only a memory. Tomorrow we may learn that each tomorrow is still out of reach. So borrow tomorrow with me. Tomorrow is too far away. Tomorrow is long to delay. Tomorrow, today will be only a memory. Tomorrow we may learn that each tomorrow is still out of reach. So borrow tomorrow with me. Is too far away. Tomorrow is long to delay. Tomorrow, today will be only a memory. so borrow tomorrow with me. Tomorrow is too far away. Tomorrow is long to delay. Tomorrow, today will be only a memory. Tomorrow, we may learn that each tomorrow is still out of reach. So borrow tomorrow with me. Is too far away. Tomorrow is long to delay. Tomorrow, today will be only a memory. Tomorrow, we may learn that each tomorrow is still out of reach. So borrow tomorrow with me. Tomorrow is too far away. Tomorrow is long to delay. Tomorrow, today will be only a memory. Tomorrow, we may learn that each tomorrow is still out of reach. So borrow tomorrow with me.
Let's bow our head and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the life of John Osborne, our beloved brother, uncle, relative and friend. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We have the assurance that he now continues on in life with you. I pray now for his family and friends, Lord, that you comfort us in this time of mourning, and you turn our tears of sadness into tears of joy as we each realize the new life that awaits each of us in Jesus Christ. May God the Father keep you in all your days. May Christ the Son shield you in your ways. May the Holy Spirit bring you healing and peace. May God, the Holy Trinity, divide all darkness from you and fill you with his love and peace. Amen. On behalf of John's family, I thank you everyone for being part of this service, and you're all invited now to continue on at the Lawn Cemetery for an interment service. As I said before, if you don't feel that you can make it there, you're more than welcome to stay here. Refreshments will be served after we come back from the interment service.
Those hands got to Thank you.